you very much, and I'm just amazed at how wonderful you are to turn up on a Saturday. I don't think I've ever seen this amount of people on a Saturday ever, or anybody ever on a Saturday, actually, so well done. It's a tribute to Avril and her team that you wanted to come here, all the work they've done. It's difficult to follow Roz because she's wonderful, but I will do my very best. What I'm going to ask you to do is to swivel around. Actually, what I was going to ask you to do is whether you wanted to come forward a bit more, or do you feel too far? Are you okay where you are? But if you came a bit forward, you might. I'm just wondering about the ones at the back. Can you swivel, come a bit forward? No, I can feel that little resistance. That's fine, everybody. You stay there, and I'll start in a slightly unusual way. What I'd like you to do is to swivel around and talk to somebody who you've not yet had a chance to talk to. Now, before you do that, to get you back, I'm going to raise my hand. If you see my hand raised, gently touch the shoulder of the person next to you, who will also raise their hands, and in that magical way, I'll get quiet, hopefully, amongst 450, because I've got a lot of little activities I want you to do. So if you can find somebody you've not had a chance to talk to, just have a little swivel across. Find somebody now, very quickly. Said what I wanted you to talk about, but you were off. Also, the other sweet thing about you were all putting your hand up but carrying on talking. What happens is you put your hand up and then you put your hand down to talk, so I bring my hand down to talk. What I want you to talk about is I want you to be very honest, because what everything that Avril's saying and everything that Roz is saying takes somebody with a lot of energy and to be totally present for the children, totally engaged. And before you can walk into a room full of children, you need to leave some of your own issues outside. It's a very simple exercise, if you can say it with me. Can you say, bin it?
Bin it.
Bag it?
Bag it.
Bring it?
Bring it.
Be very honest with your partner. What do you need to put in the bin at the moment? There's nothing you can do about it, it's happened. So you might be worried about where you've parked. It might be worried about your own child, what's happening to her this morning, or what's happening in childcare. It might be that you had an irritating bill this morning, but there's nothing you can do about it. Let it go, bin it. What do you need to put in a bag and deal with later? So something that's happened to you before you came in, that you need to go into a bag, you need to deal with it later. And what are you going to bring in with you that's going to lift people? Because we're totally responsible for our own moods and to lift other people. So it's a very simple technique. Bin it, bag it, and bring it. So I don't want you to turn to your partner and say anything too enormous, like this very morning you decide to bin your husband and get a divorce. That's too big. It's a very short speech I've got with you. But you're going to listen, because if you ask a child what makes a really good person to be with, they'll say, just it's when you come in fresh, miss. And what they mean is you come in with something totally fresh and engage with them and not bring any of the old things that happened yesterday. You're totally engaged with the children. And this is the opposite of, you know, in terms of being free range, you need yourself to be really, really positive and that lovely positive disposition. But it's difficult to be positive if you haven't binned and bagged before you come into a room. So if you can just look at your partner with light and warmth in your eyes and say, what do you need to bin, bag, and what are you bringing in today? So very quickly. Thank you to the ones who are gently tapping people. The old nudge isn't quite so wonderful, but a little tap is lovely. I'm just interrupting you for a second, because what I might do is I just might ask a table of you to speak up on behalf of your partner, because to be very, very resilient and confident, we sometimes need to speak up in front of people. So I might ask a little circle of you to speak up. So in light of this new and startling development, you might want to look back at your partner and see if they want any bits edited. Some of you might need to look back at your partner and actually ask their name, because you've just given your life away, but you forgot to ask their name. So if you are the lucky table that gets chosen, okay, just decide now, before you get chosen, do you want to edit anything? Would you rather say pass, because you don't feel that confident today, you don't feel that resilient? So go back to each other and check very quickly. Thank you. hands down. And I'm just what I'm going to do, if you all bring your hands down now, that's lovely. I might offer this microphone, and I might actually go as far as the back row, or the back circle, because they never think I'm going to travel that far. Then again, I might just go for one of the middle circles with my with my speaking object, my little, could be a tiny teddy, could be a little, it's a little tiny silver stone, and I might come here. But as I come towards you to ask you to be, if you wouldn't mind speaking up, I want you to feel the fear. If it's any consolation to you, I'm not coming, I just wanted you to feel the fear. Now the truth is, folks, that some of us actually don't like speaking up. Some of us are very anxious about it. If there's any consolation, again, if I'm going to secondary head teachers where they look so confident with their little suits on, and I walk towards them with an egg, and then half of them suddenly start to write it out. So interesting, I'll just write it down, thank you. And then some of them did what you did to me just now, which is I went towards you like this. You eyeballed me strongly. Look at me, very confident, thank you, very confident. I'm with confident friends, we're all confident, thank you. Choose them. Confident. But we're not confident. Some of you are what I call psychologically frozen children. You're not free-range children, you're frozen. You got frozen years ago by the way someone spoke to you or the way someone looked at you. And at that moment in time, some of you gave up a love of maths forever. Some of you will never sing again because you were told you can be in the choir as long as you don't let any sound out. Off you go. Some of you will never paint again because it's a shame, isn't it? Shame. But your sister was good. And that was the end of your love of painting. So some of us are frozen. And part of the passion for my work comes from my youngest child when she was 4. She put her hand up to answer a question. She got the answer wrong. The teacher made a little sarcastic comment. And the shock of laughter, because everyone laughed, was so great she never put her hand up again. So that moment was a defining moment for ourselves. And I thought about it and thought about it, because that's not a horrible teacher. She's actually a very nice woman. She lives down my road. And I thought about it more, and I thought, actually, folks, that could be me. There are days when I'm so sharp, I could not be a positive educator. I couldn't engage with children. I was too sharp at that moment. And then I thought about it more. I thought, could it be any one of us? There are days when even you know it would be dangerous for you to go out. Even you know you should stay in bed. Because there's something about you that's so sharp. Oh, dear, that's my voice. And little face, oh, that's my voice. And at that moment, you could freeze a child or you could freeze your assistant. And what we need is people who are okay. When I went towards you with the egg, you can feel the fear, honestly, you really can. And what we're frightened of is making a mistake. What you're frightened of is I gave it to you to speak, it might come out all wrong. Maybe you'll get your partner's name wrong. Maybe, and you'll look stupid. And maybe other people will judge you. And if they judge you, you know, they might think, oh, fancy that, she's not nearly as competent as she looks, is she? We're not having her at our place. That moment of judgment, it's too much. So we have to think, folks, I'm not bringing it at all. What we have to think about is that every day, there are days when we are a little bit unkind without meaning to be it. We rushed past somebody. We didn't pick up on the need of a parent who was actually really, really feeling uptight at that moment and she needed you to listen. It might have been we were unable to engage in a child because you're human. You're naturally human and all the new educational initiatives are asking for somebody who is fabulous. And to be fabulous, because to be totally present and engaged with a child, to be a really fabulous person, what we need to do is become a reflective practitioner. Every single day, we just need to sit still and say, who do I need to build a bridge back to? Which child do I need to build a bridge back to? Which parent, which of my colleagues do I need to bridge back to? And how we do that, it's huge, it's spiritual. Unconditionally, are you good at saying sorry? Just unconditionally apologizing. It's a massive big thing to do. I try and do it in my professional life. I try and sit still and think about it. But in my home life, I find it really, really hard. So when I say to my son, look, I'm really, really sorry. He often says, so you should be. Do you not think that's irritating? I can never resist it. What do you mean, so I should be? If you hadn't said that in the first place, I wouldn't have had to say what I had to say, would I? Because I wasn't that sorry. I was just saying sorry. It wasn't coming from the heart. And everything that we need to do now with children has to come from the heart. So at the, are you good at saying unconditionally sorry? Even bigger, are you good at forgiving people who are around you who have not said sorry to you? Are you good at just letting it go? It comes from the Latin meaning to let go. And if you don't, folks, in your setting, children know exactly who gets on with who. They know which of their parents you think is wonderful and which of their parents you think is substandard, because they never get the child in on time. They know which child you think is wonderful and they know which child you're really irritated with, and they tell you little tales about that child. He did that, and you can't resist it, because that's how you feel about that child. And then you've got this where bridges have gone down between people, and we are the role models to inspire children, and they can tell what's going on. And I said this one day, and a teacher came up to me at coffee time, and she said, Jenny, I know what you're talking about. She'd been in nursery school, and she'd been having a running battle with another teacher in the nursery department over the digital camera, because she felt that morally, the digital camera should stay more with her class, because her class had collected more of the Tesco vouchers towards it. We may laugh, folks, but the bridges go down between you over the silliest things. The people who leave the coffee cups lying around, the people who don't bring in the tea money on time, the people who take your parking spot when morally you know it's mine. The little tiny moments when things go down between people. So they're irritated with each other. Can I have the camera back? I won't be long, won't be long. I really want the camera back. I promise you, I'll just do one more project. Irritation. But she'd remembered, she'd been on a assertiveness course years ago when you're taught to have a little diary. So she went to the other one, she said, I'd really, really like that camera back. Could you name a day when you'd like to give it back? So they name a day, the day came and the time. She sent one of her little ones, 5, to go and get the camera. He came back, he said, oh, he said, sorry, miss, he said, she hasn't got it. What do you mean she hasn't got it? Of course she's got it. We all know she's got it, okay? We know she's got photographs going down 2 lots of corridors. She's got the camera, okay, we know it. And this little child just goes, here you are. So, that's how well they know you. They know you intimately. They know everything about you. Before we work with children, I think we should have acting lessons, so we show nothing on our face, except positivity. It's a very hard thing to do. So what we need to look into our hearts and say, am I good at forgiving people? Am I good at saying sorry when I've been a pain in the neck? Because with all the wonderful practice that you've seen, it takes such energy and such positivity. And if one member of staff is unkind about another member of staff, all your energy goes. If anyone talks behind your back, your energy goes. If people are too cliquey, your energy goes. And it's all about how the adults treat each other, whether you will be fabulous. And life's too short not to be fantastic. It's just such a short, fragile life. So I just want you to turn to the person, but be very, just don't only go as deep as you dare, and say, are you good at saying sorry to parents, to children? Are you good at, and to your colleagues? Are you good at forgiving? But don't go too deep, because you don't know if you can trust the person next to you, do you? I mean, they may go off at coffee time, lunch time, and say, we don't want her in our setting. She's a right festerer, that one. And that's integrity. Integrity is to try not to talk about people's issues. But just take a literally, and when I put my hand up, sweetheart, just quickly touch the person, because there's a lot I need to reflect on. So just turn to the person next to you and say, are you personally, it's a very, very spiritual act, are you good at sitting still at the end of the day, a reflective practitioner, to say, who do I need to build a bridge back to? I knew that it hadn't gone down well when I had my 3 teenagers in my house. I talked about this bridges and how important it was, how spiritual it was. And about a week later, I heard one of them yelling up to the other two, I'll build a bridge and get over it. But there is some truth in that, folks. The get over it bit is really important. Get over it. And what we need is a very harmonious place where at least we're going to let each other down all the time. We're going to irritate each other all the time because we're human. We're naturally irritating. But what we need to take is take responsibility and then build a bridge back to somebody. So take a few seconds, literally just a few seconds, say, are you good personally at saying sorry? Are you good at forgiving? Is it something you need to work on a bit? Okay, if you go back. I'm so sorry it's not enough time, but if anything resonates with you, just make a little note and then think, I'll talk about this with my friends or my peers later, or I'll think about it later, because it has some resonance for you. But what I'm discussing now, and this is just one bit, it might be quite useful if you want to jot a note down or scribble anything down. What I'm discussing is the big river of knowledge that's coming down towards us, a huge river of knowledge, which Donegal's tapped into, everybody's tapped into, and that's the river of social and emotional intelligence. It's a river of knowledge, and it says everything that Ros was doing, everything that Avril talked about, is understanding children's emotions and how they block learning. But actually, it's anything good in education, it's common sense, and it's been around for years. And if we read all the research, it distills itself into one line. So it was worth finding your pencil for this one line. The one line is, which you and I knew years ago, and I've been in since the early 70s, the same as some of you. The one line is, only happy and calm children learn. It's as simple as that, only happy. We have to find a level of happiness, and we have to help children with a level of calm so they can engage. But then we have some really scary facts coming from the Mental Health Association, which says that one in four children have mental health problems. So one in four children have a high level of chaos in the brain. Not anything huge, not deep psychiatric, just chaos. Oh, mum's cross with dad, missus in a funny mood, I haven't got a friend, what's gonna happen next? He started to drink too much, and it's just a little hot chaos. And we have to reach through in our setting and to be able to play alongside children to make it gentle and kind enough for children to grow, emotionally grow within that. So we have this river that's coming down towards you. And one of the key, in the UK they're doing something, social emotional learning, one of the key things we're looking for is empathy, which is all we want. Empathy is wonderful. But when you're tired, it's the first thing to go, folks. So I'll talk about that later. But empathy is a key thing. I'm going to hold this river here, which is wonderful things to explore and good, lovely books to read on social-emotional development of children. But over here, there's another river coming down towards us, huge, called neuroscience. And this neuroscience river, which has suddenly got neuroimaging, is all about how do children learn? And it tells you that empathy, it's physical things, it's about how the brain looks. And there's a wonderful book by Margot Sunderland called How the Brain Works and How Parents Can Learn About the Science of Parenting. And it shows you children's brains. You've seen about it in the paper. Children who've been too stressed and cried too much, there's too much cortisol that's been released into their brain, which has changed the shape of the brain. And the bit that you want for relationships is in the prefrontal lobes. And sometimes that's the last bit of the brain to grow. I don't know if any of you saw the program on Wayne Rooney's brain. It wasn't a short program. But what they showed was when he was younger that maybe the prefrontal lobes, which is where empathy is held, may not grow till adolescence, which is extraordinary. So maybe it won't grow till then. Now, I didn't know about empathy. This is new to me, that it's situated in the prefrontal lobes of the brain. I had to learn about it the hard way when my mother had a stroke. Because when you have a stroke, it can damage the prefrontal lobes of the brain, which has taken away her filter, and she now says just outrageous things to people. It just comes straight out. I did say to the doctors, I think she was like that before the stroke, and they said that was rude. But maybe it is. So we're looking here at the neuroscience. So I thought I'd better go on courses to find out more about the neuroscientific approach. And I went on courses, and they said, children find it difficult to concentrate because their brains are overstimulated. So you've got energy going through you. And we have to connect bits of energy. It's called brain gym, accelerated learning. I was doing all of this. I thought, but we used to do this. And we didn't used to call it brain gym or accelerated learning. We didn't used to call it any of those things. We used to call it clapping. Look at your faces. Clapping. My belief is that if our children had more access to traditional games, there would be a whole boost to the brain, which is fabulous. So we have to mix some structured play with free play. And because you've been sitting in the warm for ages, and you've been thinking for ages, to get your concentration back, I need to play a quick game with you, because it helps you to concentrate afterwards. So if you can all turn to me now, we're going to do a very simple early years clapping, which is rhythmic. And it's a sailor went to... Brilliant. Chop, chop, chop. Let's do it together, folks. Now, the reason we're doing this is because when you play Like when you're playing now, you'll be focusing on that and you will not be thinking about any of the things like wonder what's for lunch. And you won't be thinking how your children's getting on and whether you're going to get the supper. Because there are many more adults with mental health problems than children. Because today's adults are doing too much. They're trying, even you're doing so much, that you're trying to fit some more learning in on a Saturday. And everyone's rushing so much. And in order to relax, when we engage and play alongside children, it actually relaxes the brain. So this is good for you, just relax. So a sailor goes to CCC and then chop, chop, chop. So off we go, folks. You've drowned me out, I can't sing. So one, two, three. Sailor went to sea, to see what he could see, and all that he could see was the bottom of the deep blue sea. A sailor went to chop, 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 to see what he could chop, 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 and louder. Chop, 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 what's the bottom of the deep blue? Chop, 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 a sailor went to knee, knee, knee. Keep going. Knee, 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 knee. And all that he could, knee, knee, knee. What's the bottom of the deep blue? Knee, knee, knee. A sailor went to toe, toe, toe. To see what he could, toe, toe, toe. And all that he could. Sailor went to sea, chop, knee, toe, to see what he could see, chop, knee, toe, and all that he could see, chop, knee, toe. What is wonderful, and this is where the two rivers are going, when I touch hands for clapping, so, and I'm touching, touch is lovely, okay, touch is wonderful. Having a hug is wonderful. Massage, even more wonderful. But folks, it's not just wonderful. Was it gone? Let me work it back. That was so wonderful, that touch. It's not just wonderful. Something wonderful is happening. When you touch hands and you stroke, then you release into the body a hormone called oxytocin, and oxytocin makes you feel alert and able to learn. Now, we didn't know that it was oxytocin, but many, many years ago, when we were working with disturbed children, we had lovely soft animals, real animals in our classroom. We had no idea why it worked, but something happened. And years ago, with older people, they have a charity called Dial a Pet. Have you heard about that? Pets as therapy. They bring the animals in, the children stroke the animals, and they calm down. And they calm down, the older people calm down when they're stroking the animals. But much more than that, research is stunning. The research is that those settings that have had the animals come in, there's less heart disease and less visits by the GP because oxytocin is so important. So when you're doing wonderful things, it might be through clapping, it might be through the beautiful puppet that you're using, and the stroking is actually helping the child's brain. So some of you have pets like, Roz has got some lovely ones. He's a pet one here. Hello, children. I love it when I stroke. I just feel like it's the sea. I feel like I'm relaxing. It's so lovely when you stroke. Could you stroke me for a minute? Oh, thank you. Oh, that's lovely. I've got bad news for all of you. I'm actually not going to come around the whole group. Therefore, you are going to remain touch deprived and a little bit less intelligent than her. Because touch boosts intelligence. So when you're doing gentle clapping, and I don't talk about rules so much as values. We have we're gentle, we're kind. They're sort of the values that we're looking for. We do gentle clapping with each other. That will actually stimulate your brain. So there is now something quite fantastic happening. There is something called the science of emotions. It's not just that you feel happy. It's that you have released into your brain dopamine or serotonin, which makes you feel happy. When you've been cuddled, it's the release of oxytocin. It's a wonderful new decade we're in. I don't know enough about it, but I love going on courses to find about it, which is the decade of the science of emotions. So when you are playing now, when you do together, say in pairs, Just think how wonderfully it's helping your brain. As long as you don't thump them when you're playing it. A sailor, wait to. No, gently tap. So with your partner, see if you can get right through to the end quickly. Okay, lovely. And four. So it came up, it was very exciting. There were some lovely things happening. That's very rhythmic, and younger children love repetition, and it creates alpha waves in the brain that makes them very calm. So they love the gentleness of that as well. This next one very quickly to show you, it has a little edge to it. It's got a little edge of competition, but three-year-olds can do this beautifully. But we might find it very difficult. And this is where we have to have huge respect for children's brains, because they can learn things so quickly. And the games and activities that I do, I have older children teaching younger children. Not the adults teaching it, because we find it too much to take in, but the older children are the best teachers in the world. And that, funnily enough, you know, I can't clap, because I'm left-handed. And when I was in a convent many years ago, it was wrong to be left-handed, I don't know if you know that, and it was seen as a sign of the devil. So I had to have a red ribbon on my, it's about five, I had red ribbon on my wrist and donkey written on my back for quite a long time. So I get nervous, I get very clumsy. The only people I would let teach me anything are children. I love games, I know they're important, but children never judge you. I have local playgrounds, I run in, and they go, oh, here she comes, they never say, God, it's taken 2 years we're doing this one, miss, they never say 2 years. They just teach you, and they don't judge you at all. So I use a lot of older children coming down to teach younger children. And this is a very quick and easy game, but it's quite challenging for you, so let's have a little quick go together. It's, everyone, clap, together, clap, right. Clap, together, clap, left, clap, now. Don't speak, and then start speaking. Now you're multitasking. Keep it going, but don't speak. On the together, have a partner, and we're going to do fruit. Orange. Apple. Melon. Then you can't do it. One of you hesitates, and normally the children go, do, hesitation. But we can't do that. We get our hands, we shake, and we have a little scream to get rid of the tension. So 1, 2, 3. Ah! Now, is there a brave person to come up here and I'll just demonstrate? Avril. Does anybody want to volunteer? Now you can feel the adrenaline, can't you? Anybody? No, she doesn't want to. She doesn't want to, she shouldn't have to. She's on so much getting all this going. But one of you from the front? Oh, you darling, thank you. Do you want to do fruit? Do you want to do animals? What would you like?
We'll do animals.
Okay, so clap, together, clap, right. Clap, together, clap, left. Now on the together, you can say an animal, and the next together, I have to say one. And we have to see how many we can get up to. Go. When you're ready.
Cat.
Oh, dog. Now wait till the together.
Okay. Okay.
It's so hard, because the minute you think you can't, you can't. What she was helping me demonstrate is that stress and tension stop you being able to learn. The minute you're stressed, the minute you're tense, you can't learn because you think, I can't do it, they're all looking at me. And that's why we need to have a hugely relaxed easygoing settings where there's no tension. So with your partners, you're going to see, now watch how it goes, clap together, clap right, clap together. Only on the together can you say, so you might decide to do animals or fruit, anything you like, colours. What is the highest one you can get up to? What's the highest number between the two of you before it goes wrong? If you go wrong, you go like this. Ah! 1, 2, 3. CCC, it was quite easygoing. But this time, we didn't actually like losing. And you heard people go, no, 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 ready now. Now, now, now. And secretly, some of you felt you'd have done so much better if you'd had a different partner. And that's why it's so important that we move, that children can move around and meet new children. So it's not just always the one who's labelled the helpful one, who's always got to help everybody. They might want to just sometimes soar with the eagles as well, so we just make sure that there's always room for movement. But something wonderful was happening in this room. It's happened several times with Roz, lots of times with Roz, and it's been happening now. There is a fabulous sound, which is a wonderful sound. What is the sound we heard in this room? Now, laughter is the most fabulous activity a human can engage in, because that really releases into the body the most important hormone that we have. Does anyone know? It's called endorphins. Now, endorphins are released into your body if you go running for about 4 miles, you get endorphins, which makes me wonder why we bother running when we could be laughing. But there you go. Haven't quite worked it out. Now, laughter is so key. Some of you may be old enough to remember a fantastic DVD, video then, called Patch Adams. Now, Patch Adams was a doctor, Robin Williams played him. He's still alive now, he's coming back to Scotland to do talks on humour. What he showed was that humour was so important in the way that we interact with children, that they're now using it, he's changed the way that they work in hospital schools. They have laughter therapists, and all the teachers working with children who are, you know, are ill, they're taught to teach in a very warm, empathic, fun, laughter way. And in fact, Avril mentioned the importance of fun. It is key, but I go to settings where there is no fun, there is no laughter happening. I go to settings which are really quite tight with coping. Everyone's tight with coping. They're not free range running around at all. They're not the adults, they're frozen. Frozen and tight. And they make me very nervous when they're like that. They've got little staring eyes and their little jaws clenched. And I went to a thing, they asked me to come in and work with what they felt was challenging children, but actually their own behavior was very challenging. And at the time, I was reading to my own son, I was reading Roald Dahl, and he said in one of his books that his aunt's face was all pursed up like a dog's bottom. Now, I go around settings and I see lots of dog's bottoms. Tight little faces. No, we've tried that. Didn't work here. No, no, we don't want that now. No, we tried it then. 10 years ago, it won't work then, it won't work now. Thank you. Move on. Move on. Move on. Move on. Now, dog's bottoms make me very nervous. And I got them together at the end, because I don't think people are actually mean. I just think people get run down. And some of you and I turn into dog's bottoms when we're run down. So I got them together and I put them in a little circle at the end of the day, and that annoyed them. And I said to them, would it help if we put some money in together and we got a yoga teacher in? Because a yoga teacher, just for the staff, because what's really important for the adults is they do things that are going to lift their own emotional health and their own well-being. You can't keep giving out unless you put back in, folks. You can't keep on giving to children unless you refresh and re-energize. So I said, would that help? And that caused about 10 more dog's bottoms. Ooh, yoga. Yoga's a great idea. Yoga. Not social worker, but yoga. That made me nervous. Instead of backing off, I got silly. I said, okay, well, maybe not yoga. Would it help, I said, if you've got a masseuse in? Because a masseuse can do all your hands, back of your neck for you, like heads, maybe head massage. You'd feel so much better. And that sent the whole lot off into dog's bottom spasm. And I knew then I was going to find it very hard to work with them. And the truth is, folks, we have to be really very careful, because we can get ourselves into that sort of that tight little stage sometimes. And we have to go deeper than that, because it's very key. We have to look at ourselves, do we have fun? Am I the sort of person that can engage in fun? Can I laugh easily? And to do that, we sometimes need to have a bit of philosophy behind us. And my philosophy is very, very random and arbitrary. But I believe that we have to sit still every day. And the first words that we need to say is, aren't I lucky? Can you just say that with me, folks?
Aren't I lucky?
Not desperately convincing, was it, really? Some of you have got little tight faces. Aren't I lucky? She's got no idea. No idea. Okay, let's go a bit deeper to why we're so lucky. And it's called a golden moment. In that, I believe floating above our heads are the cards that life deals us. And that every single day we need to be brave and look at our cards. And some of you have got a fabulous hand of cards. And until you've gone through it, you won't realize how lucky you are. Some of you have got your health, and it's such a wonderful, it's only on loan, it's temporary. If you have got your health now, just love it, because it's a fantastic one to have. Some of you have been loved unconditionally. You didn't have to do or be anyone, they loved to see you. It could have been your nan, it could have been your dad, but they thought you were wonderful. It could have been a wonderful teacher that you met. Some children I work with and you work with have never experienced unconditional love, but some of you have. All of us have been born, I've got the peace card. I don't know why we got that peace card. It's an extraordinary card to have. People have died to give us this card. We need to love the peace. It's amazing. You've also been given the beauty card, because you're surrounded by the most extraordinary beauty I've ever seen around you. And some of you get the luxury card. Some of you actually go to hotels and people run around after you. And they've come from countries that have very bad cards. And they might have come from Eastern Europe, they might have come from Pakistan, they might have come from Bangladesh. But the cards are so bad, they have to leave their lovely country and their families. They have to stay away from them for nearly 2 years, running around after people. Every night they go back to a labor camp. And they don't see their babies for 2 years or whatever. And then they go back and they send their money each month. But we got the best cards of all. We got to work with children. What an amazing privilege that is. And Neil Passman said something wonderful. He said, children are the living messages we send to a future we will not see. So your work has the most powerful meaning of anybody's work. You've got friends who just can't believe that, that's happening. Over here, some of you have got some very difficult cards, because that is life. Some of you now have lost your health, or someone close to you has. Some of you now in a relationship and you're feeling very uncomfortable. You might feel like you're losing, you feel out of control. Might be your teenage child going off the rails. It could be your partner doesn't feel like he loves you as much, but you feel very anxious. Some of you now have the card that you're very worried about money because of the finance, and you really are, your husband or whatever, you are losing your job and you're restructured and you're feeling very worried about it. But I'm afraid, folks, it doesn't matter whether you have a wonderful hand of cards or a terrible hand of cards, there is no physical person coming to rescue you. In the end, you have to make your spirit, what Mandela calls the light inside you, which is your spirit, so strong that whatever life throws at you, you can withstand it. Whatever life throws at you, you can take it. And that's the light. And if anyone was entitled to talk about the light inside you, it would be Mandela. To be able to be locked away for 25 years, but to come out with a light of forgiveness is fabulous. And we need to learn from these people because they're giving you something amazing. So we need to have that light. And a way to make the light shine inside you strongly so you can cope with life is by having a golden moment. So what I would love you to do is to get up extra early, sit really calmly, just sit in the peace. Aren't I lucky? Take a cup of tea, because children learn by the senses and so do the adults. If you can't still the voices in your head, feel the heat of that tea. Bring it towards you, smell it, hear the peace outside and around you, the ticking of the clock. Let your shoulders go down, sip it, wonderful taste as it goes down. You say, aren't I lucky? And then you say, this is a golden moment. Can you say that with me? This is a golden moment. Right, after that, really, it's all downhill, isn't it? Because you start off really positive, don't you think? I am going to be lovely. I've been a wonderful course. I'm going to get back into my setting and I'm going to love that colleague with mental health problems. And I'm going to be wonderful to that strange, loopy child. I'm going to be fabulous because I'm engaging in a warm, empathic way. But you are going to be ambushed, because that is life. It's testing your spirit. So a parent might run into your sentence, I don't know what's the matter with Janie. She was so happy last year. Just say quietly to yourself, ah, that's an ambush. Say that with me, folks. Ah, that's an ambush. Sometimes you go down the corridor and you go, oh, interesting ambush. And sometimes you go, oh dear, group ambush. But don't say it aloud, otherwise they'll really come and take you away. It's not the end of the world. Shakespeare's a great philosopher. He said, nothing is good nor bad, but thinking makes it so. It's the way you think about things that you can catch an ambush and turn it and then walk on, but don't have to bleed from it. And what our children need is very resilient adults. Adults with a sense of fun, adults that can throw off what's happened and come and engage with them. So we need another lifting golden moment after you've been ambushed. So the most important one of the day is the lunchtime one. And I'm not asking you to go out and hug the trees, but I am saying to you, you know, all across England now I've got people sitting in stockroom cupboards with little iPods listening to lovely music of water, smelling and tasting their food and rocking. And saying things like, I'm perfectly normal. I'm just having a golden moment. I'll be all right. If that's what it takes, that's what it takes, folks. And I had this lovely, lovely story when fairly recently a teacher came up and said, my head went on one of your courses and came back and said, at lunchtime, we've all got to have a golden moment, all of us, so that we're calm with the children. She got a yoga teacher in and she taught all her staff, she said, you know, go into your classrooms at lunchtime, wherever you want to do it in this cupboard, but you're just to lie down on the ground, tense your face and relax, tense your shoulders and relax, tense your buttocks and relax. And it is a beautiful yoga technique because the more you tense and then relax, you feel very, very at home and comfortable with your body and very light, and it makes you just think the world is wonderful. So she gets them all doing it, and because she's a great person, she's a role model, she does it herself. You can't preach to people unless you're prepared to do things yourself. So she goes into her office, she lies on the ground, she puts some very calm music and she lights some incense. And she has her particular golden moment. Well, this particular day, a very difficult little child had been good. And he'd been sent in with his mate to tell her how good he's been. He cannot believe his luck, he's good. He's been good. Somebody spotted him being good. So he's outside her door, this nursery school, she's lying inside. And she could hear him saying to his little mate, she's saying, she's going to be thrilled with me, really thrilled she is. Because she always says, I ruin her day. I ruin it. But I ain't ruined it today because I've got a sticker to prove it. I've got a sticker. Anyway, opens the door. And of course, it is the one day she'd forgotten to lock it. Opens the door, sees her lying on the ground and just goes, ow, bugger, she's dead. Top corridor going, always happens to me. Bless his little heart, eh? Isn't that awful? You get your sticker and they die on you. That must be the worst ambush in the world, I think. That's the worst ambush. But bless that little setting as well, because they're laughing about it. It's not the end of the world. But you do need a closing golden moment before you go home. Now, what's wonderful in early years is it's very sensory. If you were to sit in your car on your journey and you were to just open up a tangerine and smell it, the sense of smell brings back fabulous happy memories of when you were abroad or something wonderful happened to you. If you played some beautiful, if you've noticed, folks, world music is very happy music from other countries that are very, very poor, very oppressed. But that's the happiest music, because in the end, that's all there is. There is laughter, there is fun, there is dancing. That's your spirit, so we have to do that. So we need a little golden moment before you go home, because some of you do go home and you do moan a little bit, don't you? And I need to tell you that some of your partners are bored with you. Just thought I'd tell you. So it might be nice to go home and say, wow, great thing happened today, and then lift it. So just put your hands together, because we're all kinesthetic learners. You wake up tight with coping, and you're going to have an opening golden moment. So just say the word open. You're going to be ambushed, because that's life. No one said life would be easy. It's just part of life. And when you're ambushed, what are you going to say? Ah, that's an ambush. 10 ambushes later, you need a golden moment at lunchtime. I don't mind what you do, but you find one, and that's called a lifting one. Say the word lift. Yes. Lift. And before you go home, so you go home positive, a little closing moment called close. Okay. You have 1 second to tell the person next to you, do you have a golden moment? Is it socially acceptable to talk about? And is it every day? Now, is it the lifting one? Is it the opening one? Is it the closing one? A lot of people who work with children are too tired. They go home and they moan. They think, oh, I have a dreadful day. I'll have a little gin and tonic. Then they say, no, really dreadful day, double gin and tonic. And what they're doing is they're awarding themselves for moaning. So I'm saying, get the treats in every day. You don't have to moan to get them. And that's a totally different way of thinking. If you moan and give yourself a treat, that's reactive. If you actually have it in every day, that's proactive, and you're going to lift it. And what settings do is get together, and they make sure they have treats together as well, which is lovely. So quickly tell the person next to you, do you have a golden moment? Ones. It is too short, but we're just catching up with ourselves at the moment. So if it matters to you, don't just leave it. It's really important, and there's a lovely, we have a golden inspiration board in our staff room. It's just worth putting one up, and the one that goes with that I think is very lovely. It says, the past is history, the future a mystery, but now is a gift. That's why we call it the present. So the present of the now and living in the moment is such a rare and wonderful gift, and we are amongst the top 1% of luckiness, folks. But we need to be playful learners, and we're going to get up, and I'm going to get a song that some children taught a friend, and it's so daft, I'm going to teach you. So if you just stand up with me, folks, because you've already learned I can't sing, so you just have to sing along with me. These words came from children. And they all do it together, and they have a laugh. So whenever anyone's down, they say, let's all sing that song. So together, if I do that, you shout, we. Okay, so when I do that, you shout, we. And they say, can turn around, come back to the beginning. Okay, 1, 2, 3. We can turn around. Oh, we're going to wander around for a long walk. Okay. We can turn around quickly, but it wouldn't go in. Then you shout again, we.
We
can touch the ground. Everybody?
We can touch the ground.
Stay with me. The incentive is you can get to lunch, otherwise we're here a long time. We might lose our lunch. So 1, 2, 3, another we.
We
put our hands on our hips. 1, 2, 3.
We
put our hands on our hips.
We
can dance like this. Together.
We can dance like this.
Shake your body, shake your body.
Shake your body, shake your body.
More shaking.
Shake your body, shake.
And your shoulders.
Shake your body.
More.
Shake.
Louder.
Shake your body, shake your body.
Get ready. Shake your body, shake your body. We can.
can turn around.
We
can touch the ground. Shout it.
We
put our hands on our hips.
We
can dance like this. Shake your body, shake, shake your body.
Shake your body, shake, shake your body.
Lower.
Shake your body.
Bottoms up, lower. Keep going.
Shake your body, shake, shake your body.
Now come up. Louder.
Shake, shake your body.
Really loud.
Shake your body, shake, shake your body.
One louder.
Shake your body.
Now you're going to do free.
Shake your body.
You're going to do a free dance, but keep the rhythm. Right, free dance. Shake your bar. Free dance. You do free dance, not just me. Bar free dance. That's it, thank you.
Okay, many thanks to Jenny Mosley. There was an absolutely inspirational and creative, wonderful. Thank you, Jenny.